Okay, I'd like to open the meeting on social services, veterans, culture, and recreation. To my right, I would like to introduce City Councilor from Ward 4, Gina Louise Shira. And to my left is Councilor Elisa Klein from Ward 7, and I'm City Councilor Miriam LaBarge from Ward 6. I'm the chair.
Can we turn on the camera?
Yeah, let's go.
All members are present. I'd like to announce the announcement of audio-video recording of this meeting, and I also would like the approval of the minutes of September 21st of 2:15.
Move to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any public comment? And I don't see any public. So, I would like to introduce Phil Corman, who's the Executive Director of Community Involved Sustaining Agricultural, CISA. And Phil, it is an honor to have you here.
Thanks for having me.
So, you're going to do a presentation for us, and you've got an hour.
It's a lot of time.
Almost an hour to tell us all about CISA.
I'd appreciate it if we go back and forth rather than me talking at you for an hour. A little background on CISA, Community Involved in Sustaining Agriculture. We started over 20 years ago, and it started for some of the same challenges that local farms still face today. It started among organizations and the colleges and farmers trying to take a look at challenges that local farms were facing, which ranged from how to run and have an economically sustainable farm, how to deal with competition globally and nationally, how to protect farmland so it's accessible, how to respond to the fact that the next generation was often choosing not to stay in farming, and then what's going to happen with the farm if the next generation is doing something else. Our work has been, how do we ensure that we can strengthen local farms, and how do we engage the community in building a local food economy? So that's our mission statement. In your packet, I have the annual report sitting there with the strategic plan facing you on the right side, sort of a one-pager. And I would say that our work has been successful to a large degree because I think that we've been able to tap into certain values our community has, and we've been able to promote and encourage residents to act on their better selves and their better values. So the Local Hero Program, which we're best known for, started in 1998, and that's the Be a Local Hero, Buy Locally Grown. I'm sure you've seen this, but I did bring copies for you.
Great. Thank you. We do
60,000 copies of the Farm Products Guide. We distribute it through the three counties of Hampshire and Franklin counties. And now we have over 250 farms are involved in the three counties. And we have over 150 other businesses, which includes like 50 to 60 restaurants, colleges, retirement homes, landscaping, et cetera, et cetera. So our first successful venture has been, how do we help make it more possible for both for all of us as residents to identify what's locally grown? So when we go to a supermarket, we go to a corner store, whether it's Cereals or Cooper's or whatever, or we go to River Valley Market or Big Y, we know it's locally grown because there's often a Be a Local Hero, Buy Locally Grown sticker on there on the different products. And then the other part is we've made it more possible for farmers to sell directly to all of us. So Northampton has three farmers markets, which is pretty incredible for a city of 30,000 people. Springfield has a city of 150,000 and has maybe three markets, depending on the season. So that's been very successful, and we've been able to increase the amount of direct sales that farmers are able to do commerce with residents in the three counties. And that's really made a difference for a lot of smaller farmers because, for instance, if I am a farmer nationally and selling my lettuce, conventional lettuce, the average price for a head of lettuce is $2.15. I, as the farmer, may keep 70 cents of that transaction. The rest go to the distributor, the supermarket, wherever that head of lettuce has traveled to get to the supermarket. If I'm selling it at a farmer's market, I, as the farmer, keep every penny. Granted, I had to stand there for a couple hours. I had to travel to the farmer's market to do it, but there's no middle person. So for small farms, or for larger farms who like selling direct, we've made it more possible. Some of the other things we've worked on over the last 4 or 5 years, we've set up a emergency farm fund after Hurricane Irene, you can say tropical storm Irene, hit us in the three counties. We raised $200,000 from the community and set up a no interest loan fund for farmers who get impacted by natural disasters. We've had 14 farms take no interest loans out from that fund. They don't have to pay anything back the first year. They pay back over 3 years, and it's between $5,000 and $10,000 they can borrow, no interest. And it's, the purpose of it is really not to replace the federal government, which does the lion's share of emergency response, but to give a quick turnaround to small farms who need to buy inputs to enable them to plant their crops and seed their crops and still stay in business if they start making money when the harvest comes in. We've done more work in Hampden County because 2 out of 3 people live in Hampden County in the three counties. It's more people in Springfield than Hampshire County. So we never had the same level of visibility as we've had in Hampshire and Franklin, and so we're doing more in Hampden County. We're trying to work more with beginning farmers than we've done in the past. And then this year, working with Una Koi, at the Tuesday market and some of the, and the Florence market and the Saturday market and the Amherst market, we started a SNAP and SAVE program, which enables residents, households that are on SNAP, parentheses, food stamps, that the first $5 is matched that they spent at the farmers markets. The Tuesday market had been doing a great job of exhausting fundraising to do this in the past. And we've been able to start doing it for the 4 markets. And we're launching sort of an initiative over the next couple of months called Local Food for All, which will have this portion of SNAP and SAVE, again, the matching of food stamps at farmers markets in the three counties. And we also want to expand the number of senior farm shares that we deliver in the three counties, including what Grow Food Northampton does. There's 425 low-income senior farm shares delivered. So our goal is going to be to raise $100,000 between now and May. And that will enable us, again, to cover the farmers markets with a minimum of a $5 match for folks on SNAP, maybe up to 10. If we raise the full $100,000, it also increase senior farm shares, 50 to 100 more people. And then after that fundraising effort, there is federal USDA money coming through the State Department of Transitional Assistance in 2017 for 3 years, 17, 18, and 19, that will provide a match statewide at farmers markets for households on SNAP. And our hope is also in the next 4 years, we'll have the state legislature interested in funding SNAP at farmers markets, so when the USDA grant runs out in 2019, the Commonwealth has made a commitment to pick it up.
We'll see.
Right now, there's about $1 billion of SNAP spent in the Commonwealth, and only about $360,000 of that $1 billion is spent at the farmers market by households on SNAP. So, the more we can increase the spending on local food, the greater the impact we have on our local economy.
Do you know how much of that billion is spent on fruits and vegetables, period?
No, but there was a study done in Hampden County, the only county in the country with USDA funding, that showed, and that study done with App Associates took a look at 7,500 households on SNAP in Hampden County. Half were like a control group that didn't receive a benefit. The other half got just 30% back when they bought produce. It didn't have to be local, didn't have to be fresh, could be fresh, frozen, or canned. And so if you bought $5 worth of produce, you got a third of that automatically credited back to your account, so like $1.70. And it showed that people who got that benefit increased their consumption of produce, fruits and vegetables, 25%, which is a decent amount. They were only consuming about a cup a day, so it went up to a cup and a quarter, but that's statistically significant and also significant enough to make a difference in health outcome. So that's why it's important to make it more possible for people to buy fruits. Yeah. So that's sort of my overview, and here to answer any questions you have about. See, so a third of our board by our bylaws have to be farmers. So we have a board of 19. We're a nonprofit organization right now. I think it happens to be 8 out of 19 people are farmers. Our board, so the farmers on the board include the farmers at Hampshire College, Old Friends Farm, Warner Farm in Sunderland, Clarkdale Farm in Deerfield, Kaczynski Farm in Westfield, Maple Line Farm.
Is the Ravenwood Farm on there?
No, they're not on our board, but they are a local hero member. Mm-hmm. And then the other board members range from Russ Piotr, who hits up WGBY, Lori Estes, who used to work at Girl Scouts in Western Mass and is a financial investment person, Rachel Moore, who was at Smith College and now is at Proteus Fund, sort of other people.
So you mentioned that you're trying to do more and more work in Hampden County, and
so that's not it. That's not to do less. Just, you know.
No. So are you trying to target sort of like quote unquote food desert areas, or how do you combat that?
So for us, it's not just Springfield, not just Holyoke. Hampden County is 450,000 people, so 2 out of 3 people don't live in Springfield. So for us, our first task is, since it's about strengthening farms, it's about providing technical assistance to the farms that already exist in Hampden County and making it more possible for them to economically survive and thrive. Farmers make less money on average in Hampden County than Franklin and Hampshire. Some of that is because it's more urban, they're a little more isolated, there's a different culture a little bit, you know, south of Holyoke, I think, than north. So that's our, and we've gotten more farmers to join, and now we're trying to provide more services for them, connect them to more restaurants they can sell to, try to identify these farms more easily for consumers in Hampden County so they patronize these farms. And then in terms of people who don't have the purchasing power to pay the prices local farmers need to charge, or even supermarkets need to charge, part of it is trying to strengthen the farmers markets. There's a couple of farmers markets in low-income areas, and those are always more challenging because people, again, have less disposable income. Ironically, in the United States, we spend a very small portion of our disposable income on food. It's only about 10%. But if you're the bottom 20% in earning, you're spending about a quarter of your disposable income. So even though everyone's sort of like, oh, I can't believe food prices keep going up, they keep going up. Ironically, we as a nation spend one of the lowest amounts of disposable income.
That even includes like going to restaurants and...
Well, that's right. Yeah, that's sort of that.
I'm surprised it's only 10%.
Yeah. So that's interesting, right? I think part of that is because we notice prices going up in food because we purchase it on a weekly basis. We don't maybe notice it much on other things that we have, or we think, well, I didn't notice on the car because I didn't buy one for 10 years and I expected it to go up. But again, if you're low income, you know, farmers have a price they need to charge to sustain their business, it's more challenging. Not that local food is necessarily more expensive.
So you said if you're low income, you're more likely to spend closer to 25% of your income.
Of your disposable income on food because your disposable income is so small.
Okay, so it's not because they're necessarily having to shop at places that have higher prices because we have this issue of inaccessibility of food.
That may be some of it. I didn't dig further than that. Yeah.
I mean, because we know that we have this problem that in low-income neighborhoods, people are shopping at 7-Elevens because they don't have access to grocery stores and so forth. So I'm just wondering if they're necessarily needing to shell out more of their money because of where they have the ability to shop.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Just to kind of build on that, have you been involved at all in urban farming programs in Springfield and Holyoke? I know that Springfield has a pretty active...
So there's two nonprofits that are local here, members of CISO. U.S. Class has been around 25 plus years and has a national reputation of providing people who want to begin farming the opportunity to do that, or they may have farmed in Puerto Rico or another country and have come to this, has come to Holyoke. They also run a farmer's market and they've ebbed and flowed on different enterprises they've done. And then the other one is Gardening the Community in Springfield, which they're not trying to train people to be farmers. They're basically trying to provide more good food in their community and running a youth empowerment program by expanding the amount of empty lots that can turn into community gardens and reclaim neighborhoods in that way and have people feel some connection to the food that can be grown in their neighborhood. And they connect with a farm, and they also do some delivery of CSA farm shares from Next Barn Over in Hadley. And they also sell at farmers markets some of the food that they grow. And so we work with them. Yeah, they do great work.
Right now,
urban farming does not grow a lot of food, but it does really, really well is give people some power and control over some food that they can grow themselves and feel that understanding and connection that you can grow food and if you're not totally dependent on a system that's not getting fresh food to you.
Well, it also kind of creates and enhances community in a new way.
I think food is, I think all of us, I mean, that's why we say eat. As we lovingly give food to a family member.
How are dairy farmers doing locally?
So our dairy farmers, I think the statistic is, if I can remember it correctly, in the last 50 years, we've lost 95% of our dairy farms in Massachusetts. And that's, it's complicated for why, but in part it's because the price of milk when a dairy farmer is selling it wholesale is determined at the national level, and that price is not high enough to reflect the costs of producing milk in New England.
How many dairy farmers do we have, say locally?
Well, in Massachusetts, off the top of my head, I think it's about 135 in all of the Commonwealth. So some of our dairy farmers in Western Mass, the ones that are left standing and farming are generally the ones that always have done a really good job. It's not to say that someone that failed wasn't doing a really good job, because that's sort of blaming someone for a system that is not working for smaller, smallish dairy farms. But, you know, we've had some very innovative models, Maple Line, which has its own milk processing plant. And because they do, they're allowed to produce a certain amount of milk that they can sell at the price they want. So that's and by delivering it directly to people, they can get off with filling a niche that's a little higher end. And then you have dairy farms that have moved into, you know, specialty products like yogurt or cheese. And that enables you to charge any price as long as the consumer is willing to pay it, but you're not limited by the federal price of milk. So that's been the way, and then, you know, we still have some dairy farms that are selling wholesale into the milk pool that are making it because they just work really, 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 really hard. Yeah, it's really tough. Yeah.
Farming is very difficult.
Yeah. So, and dairy farms are pretty important because they have a lot of farmland that they control, I mean, in their holdings. So when you lose, and they also, you know, use equipment and all that, so they're an important part of our agricultural infrastructure for those reasons. Besides the fact that most milk is not, doesn't usually travel that far. So New England, New York milk generally stays in the region. So when you talk about wanting to have a regional food economy, milk, and there's only three things we produce here that we drink besides water, you know, milk, cranberry juice, and cider. So it's interesting when you think how orange juice became the breakfast drink of choice. Mm-hmm. I mean, so much marketing. You know, when you think about it, it's a little bit acidic, you know, you sort of notice that. Do you like it? It's fresh. Is it fresh? Well, no, it's usually reconstituted, you know. It's not as if an orange just got squeezed. You know. It's coming 1,200 miles. And yet, you know, we have cider, milk, cranberry juice right here in the state.
Now, like Atkins, I mean, that place is busy all the time. So they're part of CSET, aren't they?
Yes, they are.
Other vegetables.
Yes, yes, they're part of CSET. And, you know, that family and, you know, Pauline Lannan, you know, the farm part has gotten a little smaller over time as they've made more and more of a decision to grow the farm stand into this beautiful supermarket. But their commitment to local means that they really understand what it means to farm and try to source a lot locally, and now they have their North Amherst mm-hmm. store too as a second store, and they have been looking for a long time trying to figure out where they may want to have a second outlet.
Is
that
opened yet?
Yeah, it opened up a couple of weeks ago. That's the whole redevelopment that Cowles has been doing.
Right, yeah.
Where is that located?
Where Cowles Lumber, that part.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
There's a great restaurant there too. Well, I guess breakfast and lunch restaurant.
And that's part, you know, yeah. Part of local complex. Yeah.
It scares me though sometimes when you buy a business and you have all the employees who yeah. apparently have shares in it, and then they're doing so great, then all of a sudden they're expanding, and that scares me.
Mm-hmm. Well, I wouldn't be that nervous, Brad. I mean, I just think that Pauline's a really good businesswoman, and they've been contemplating this at least over 10 years. They were thinking Springfield, maybe, or they were thinking Deerfield, and this opportunity came up in North Amherst. So my guess is they looked at the numbers and, you know, what's the market, and felt like they could. And it's a smaller store. It's a much smaller store than the footprint that's in. So.
What about, like, with meats like your lamb and that? How many farms do we have?
So I don't know the number off the top. So any question you ask me, like, I could find that out, and you can email me, and I have my business card there, so anything, or you can tell me to note it down and I can get back to you. So, you know, it's interesting that we have a butcher that has a commitment here in town to only sourcing local animals. They had looked throughout New England. They came from Brooklyn. My niece, who's a butcher in Brooklyn, knows them. And it's a small group of people who are interested in this art of butchering and committing to local animals. And they're pleased with how their business is taking off. And there's meat farmers who are pleased that they're able to do business directly with them. So Sutter's is great. That's really exciting. And when I went in there, when they first opened up, like, I had no idea how many people had moved from Brooklyn to this area. But I was just hanging out at the store, and someone comes in and says, oh, I've been dying for this. You know, I was like, where are you from, Brooklyn? You know, so, you know, you have this whole subculture of immigrants from other places.
Which is great.
Which is great. It's great. So, and we've seen how River Valley Market has taken off. You know, they're up to about 7,500, you know, members, and they're thinking about where their next store would be.
Oh, really?
Because they're hitting their capacity, whether it's parking, whether it's, I mean, they're renovating the store again to create more space, but they're limited by their physical footprint. And so, yeah. And I think we have to make sure we keep all our corner stores going, whether it's, you know, Cereals or State Street or Cooper's or Cornucopia, because they play a really important role too. They're, and part of what people don't realize is that national brands basically buy shelf space in national retail supermarkets. So if you remember back when, like, Ben and Jerry's took on Haagen-Dazs, that was their whole marketing campaign. They couldn't even get their ice cream on the shelf in supermarkets because Haagen-Dazs, in essence, owned the space in those supermarkets. And the same thing happens when you see strawberries. I'm trying to remember Driscoll strawberries, right, all year round. Driscoll basically has an arrangement with those supermarket chains that Driscoll will supply you with strawberries every day of the year, but you have to give me this retail space in your store. So when you get to a corner store, a store like Cereals is always willing to provide an opportunity for a new product, whether it's grown here, grown and packaged here, or even just packaged here, where they're willing to say, well, we'll give it a shot, you know, we'll give you part of the shelf, and if it takes off, we're glad to have you stay there. And obviously, if it doesn't sell over a certain amount of time, we'll, you know, open it up for someone else. So, you know, that commitment to buying from each other and, you know, the networking of local businesses is really important.
Talking about Driscoll's reminds me of something that I've been wanting to ask you about, and that is, does CESA play any role in kind of looking at the labor market of workers for picking and all the other phases that workers are kind of imported for use? And do you have any kind of policy about the farms that you accept as local producers, CESA producers and so forth? How does that all work?
That's a really good question. We are challenged by that issue as a nonprofit because over the years we've focused on the farmers, and the farmers are family-owned farms, and the farmers are working with the farm workers, and they're on the smaller side. So you could say in general we've been working with the employers, even if it's a family farm of six people where four of the people are in the family and two people are not. We've been clear through our strategic planning that we feel that farm workers, that farms need to make enough money so that families of the farmer and the farm workers have sustainable living. And we've been trying to, we've done workshops for farmers so they understand the laws around hiring and the requirements. But we haven't gone very far down the road of how do we work both, in this case, with employers and the employees, in this case, the farmers and the farm workers. In general, you know, I would say that farmers generally are a pretty honest lot here in Western Mass. You'll always find someone who maybe isn't doing the right thing. We don't make it right now a requirement of being in the local agreement program. We don't really have a way to, I mean, we could do a living wage thing, but we haven't done that. The minimum wage just went up, which a lot of farms feel challenged by. And I think the difficulty is that local farms are at a size and have so little control over their market that it's a challenge to make a living. That doesn't mean that farm workers shouldn't make an adequate living. It just means that the farmers, local farmers, are limited by how high a price they can charge. And at some point, they may price themselves. They're scared about pricing themselves out of the market. So I think it means that we need to have a lot more conversations between those who are solely focusing on and advocating for farm workers in this area and those who are trying to support farmers so that the business stays alive. And I think we just need more conversation. There's been a couple of sweet spots that haven't gone as far as maybe they can. There is an organization, and right now I'm forgetting the organization, that was focused on ensuring that immigrants who are not legally in this country would not, if they got stopped for a misdemeanor, that local police would not be calling in the federal INS, I guess it is, maybe. And also to allow immigrants who are in this country, perhaps not legally, to be able to get a driver's license. And that is that might be a sweet spot for farmers, that they would feel comfortable and want to help on that. Both those, because they have no desire to have someone who's been working on their farm for 3 years to take the tractor off the farm, and then they find out he didn't come back. Why didn't he come back, he or she? Because they're being held in county jail, and INS is about to deport them. I mean, so.
Problem is, it's a local jurisdictional
correct.
Thing. So the Northampton passed a Trust Act, a trust policy essentially correct. That says.
This was an attempt to pass it statewide.
Oh, okay.
So that all communities, you wouldn't have to go one by one. So I was.
But that's a very narrow window of what kind of protection
yes.
they have. You know,
yes.
and that also is not protecting the employer per se if they're found to be employing people who are illegal and so forth. So
I think, you know, we're going to have to hit our heads against the wall and keep thinking about this because it's important. It's important. The value of the organization, that farm worker families, adequately too.
So you don't do any kind of screening process in terms of who a local bureau can be or can't be?
We don't do we don't do a social screen based on who you hire. Mm-hmm. And that would be beyond the capability of an organization that has 11 full-time equivalents for 250 plus farms. Mm-hmm. If you know of a funding source that would want to do this forever with us, that could be helpful. But and that's where it is helpful that our board has farmers on it, because if we can't work it through at the board level, we're not going to be able to work it through at the farmer level either. So
and what was the concerns the farmers on the board about something like that?
We haven't had that conversation per se. Like, I mean, we've talked about it some, and the farmers and the board in general, if you look at our strategic plan, I mean, one of our values, you know, is that we do want farm worker families to make a living that's sustainable for them too. It just means the farm has to make enough money for everybody to make a sustainable living, and we have so many farms that are threatened that it's hard to add things when they keep getting added. And I'm not saying this isn't totally justified, needs to happen. The question is, how do we make it happen where local farms can still stay in business? So it's very hard. I mean, especially when there's other things that are costing local farms way more, a higher percentage of their income as compared to large industrial farms, like food safety regulations that are getting passed that are based on risks found at very large farms. Industrial processing doesn't mean there's no risk of food safety issues at a small farm. It may not be the same ones, and the costs around many parts of those regulations could put a farm out of business. That's that small.
How involved is CISA in other kind of stages of food kind of processing, getting it out onto the market, all of that, and involved in maybe incubator kinds of businesses that can help with all the different phases of food production?
So we get calls all the time from people who have creative ideas. So maybe I'm thinking about doing this. Does this make sense? Anybody doing this in the area? How would I start? Where can I get some business assistance? So we work with, and then we publish some things. You'll see in your packet, there's two educational materials. One is growing on, you know, one's about scaling up the local food system, and then the other one's taking action on local food. So with other small investment groups, the Franklin County CDC has launched an investment fund, and that enables all of us who would like to invest some money in the local food system, the same way that River Valley Market raised money not the same exact way, but the same way Real Pickles was able to raise money. Basically, you can put money in with the Franklin County CDC's investment fund, and that money then provides loan money to entrepreneurial farms for enterprising beginning businesses that want to fill niches in the local food system. So we've worked on a variety of stuff, whether it's been meat processing, chicken processing, dairy, and all that. And we usually sort of hold some of the common knowledge of who knows the most in the area and where does that material live. And, you know. And then once a business is established, we help them market themselves. So the technical assistance we'll provide to farms and businesses that source from local farmers will be on everything but growing practices. So we'll help a local farm, how do you set up a farm stand, or how do you write a press release? How do you analyze your business to know what's costing you more, but maybe has more potential than other parts of your business? We do meet and greets for restaurants and farmers so that commerce can happen with 10 restaurants and 20 farmers right there and then. We help farmers gain some of the skills they need. They often are very highly skilled to grow what they're growing, but they may not have some of the business or people skills around the selling part.
What about food processing kind of plants, though? I mean, I know there's the collective in Greenfield.
Well, that's part of the Franklin County CDC.
Oh, that's what you're mentioning.
They have the food processing center.
Yeah.
So that's run by the CDC, but, you know, we'll, you know, refer people to them. Then there's some other businesses that have some, they've graduated from the food processing center, like Appalachian Naturals and Real Pickles. And then again, when a business decides to do some processing, we can help them figure out what they want to do, how they want to do it, get them some marketing and media attention for it. We oftentimes have some grant monies to have someone mentor someone else, so we may have another farmer mentor a farmer, or we may have a someone like Atkins come and mentor a corner store that's not competing with them, and things like that. Oftentimes we hear from a business that's in trouble and try to help them so they get out of trouble and keep the doors open. Yeah.
You mentioned a couple of policy things as you were talking, the SNAP and some other. What other are there kind of policy issues that your organization has been working with at the State House around or locally?
Yeah. So this big one is going to be over time will be to make sure that the Commonwealth is we were instrumental in ensuring that the State Department of Transitional Assistance followed through on the grant they got from the USDA. There was a change in administration. The Department of Transitional Assistance had some challenges that were bigger than the grant, and so we were able to provide them with the support so they can make that little bit of a leap, not just us alone, but other groups, so they can make the leap and go ahead with this matching of SNAP and farmers markets across the Commonwealth. Right now, there's a statewide food system plan that is going to be released on Friday, and that comes out of the Massachusetts Food Policy Council, started up a couple of years ago. Representative Hewitt has been instrumental in that. It's made up of some state agencies. Representative Hewitt's on it, and there's a farmer or two in the Massachusetts Farmers Market Organization. They basically commissioned for a food system plan to be developed about how to grow the local food system statewide and how to increase the consumption of Massachusetts food that's grown and processed here, including seafood. It's the first really comprehensive plan done since the mid-70s, so the first one in 40 years. It gets released on Friday. It's a draft. for public comment. Public has this opportunity to make comments on it. Then it will go to the Food Policy Council and then to the governor. And the hope is that there are recommendations in there that will provide a point of policy change and action throughout the Commonwealth. And we were one of, you know, 50 to 100 groups involved in that.
Will CISA be involved in kind of putting it out there to the public for the public?
We will in our local area here. The Franklin Regional Council of Governments has been involved. Whitten Pitcock, who lives in Franklin County, has sort of been the lead consultant with, I forget the name of the Planning Council in the Metropolitan District. He also serves as head of the Maple Growers Association. And the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission has also been involved. So we've, Western Mass has had a lot of good involvement in this.
Do you know if there'll be like a survey or some component of it that would be sort of easy for people to give feedback on?
Yeah, that's, I don't know how they're releasing it and how it's going to look when it's on the website. It's a lot.
I assume it's going to be a big plan to wait for it.
You need some expertise, I would imagine.
It is, I mean, there are different sections, and another local Northampton resident, Alex Risley Schroeder, was very involved around careers in the local food system statewide and thinking about issues like that. So the hope is, if you're interested in the land issue, if you're interested in the fish issue, if you're interested in how to do marketing around this, if you're interested in social equity in the food system and how do we make sure there's social justice for all, at least you'll be able to go to that section and dive in and look through it and make comments.
So I have another question. Sorry.
Keep going.
Anybody else has questions?
I'm thinking.
Go for it. One of the things that came up at the meeting that came out of the work that the Smith students did, that CISA was kind of involved with, and was talking about the need, they had identified the need for a kind of local food hub kind of place for sales and year-round farmers markets and all that kind of stuff. We don't actually have that kind of thing in a place where we have focused so much on agriculture. So I'm wondering if that is something that CISA's thinking about, promoting, working towards. Is there anyone in the Valley working towards that?
So I'm always confused by the term local food hub because I don't really know what it means. In other words, it gets used lots of ways by lots of people in lots of circumstances. So it's easier for me to talk about, like, in some ways, you know, we have a processing center in Franklin County. I'm not convinced it's at full capacity, and I'd have some concerns about another food processing center done with public funds until that one's at capacity, for instance. Maybe we all have to do a better job of making it possible for people in the three counties to know about it and helping the food processing center maybe be able to respond to the needs of many clients. So that's oftentimes considered part of the food hub. A year-round market, part of the challenge with that is it's hard to have a physical space that it wouldn't be just used for one thing, because so in the winter, that's why, you know, the Northampton winter market is at Smith Vocational School, because at a school that's not used on the weekends, you have a physical facility, so you're filling a niche there. But if you just had a building that was only for a farmer's market, what's happening with it the other 6 days of the year? And it's not clear to me, like, I know that Representative Story had interest in doing an indoor market, perhaps in Amherst, and it wasn't clear to me that people in Northampton would cross the river to go to Amherst, and I'm not convinced that people in Amherst would cross the river and come to Northampton. Now that there's two winter markets, there's one in Greenfield, there's one in Springfield, there's one in Northampton, and then one in Amherst, and I'm not convinced the demand is there that if you did something. I mean, I think there's creative conversations that could be happened around the trying to think, the name just went for me. Where we hold our the fairgrounds. Yeah, you know.
Right.
I mean, there's been some conversation, could we have a building there that's serving sort of as a wholesale market for restaurants and farmers, and that would be the location of it. I think, you know, it's just, it's sort of a high bar for investment to make that happen. And again, what's happening in that physical space the other days, maybe it could work if that physical space is being used. But then we'd have to, I think we'd have to do more work to understand, will restaurant owners want to come to a place where it's only one day a week to get something?
I think the vision is probably is more of an urban vision, as it were, but I think the vision is a place like Pike's Market in Seattle, where,
right,
you know, it's not just a farmer's market one day, it's,
right,
you know, all week there's,
right,
stuff going on, there are little restaurant booths, there,
right,
there's fish, there are vegetables, there,
yeah,
so it's a very kind of vibrant place, and it could be attached to a processing center, or,
right,
but the idea being that it's kind of a food hub and has all manner of things going on in a, on a daily basis,
right,
and, which
so
I think
we
is a great
have,
vision for a city. I'm just,
yeah,
not sure, like you say, that Northampton, for instance,
yeah,
can sustain something like that.
So in Boston, there is now the indoor public market. It opened up this past season. It's open year-round, open 5 days a week. And, you know, they have raised a lot of money to make that happen. They got some state property to open up in, but it's a nonprofit that's running it, and private vendors have to pay to build out their space, and they have, I think, a five-year lease, and everyone's taking a risk together. And so far, early on, so good. We won't know for a couple of years, really. If, you know, so everyone's very hopeful about it. There was conversations of trying to do something in Springfield at one point, and trying to think of the person, Ann Burke, was very involved with some financial planning around that. Ann Burke stands on the Western Mass Economic Development Commission, I think. She also sits on our board. So she was looking at that like 10 years ago. And it was challenging even to figure out how to make that work in Springfield. And it never, the planning went pretty far, but it never made those final couple of hurdles. And as I say all this, this doesn't mean that I don't think we could be doing more and more and more. I'm just not clear whether and it'll be interesting to hear from Una what she thinks, whether a permanent physical space year-round would be ideal, or how does it work to have a three-season market happening, you know, behind Thorns? Is that, you know, that'll be a great question to ask Una.
The winery on Sylvester Road.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, the owners are fantastic.
Former school employee.
Mm-hmm. And we've had and held several functions at their pavilion.
Yeah.
And if you go by during the summertime, it's booked.
Yeah.
You know, and I know former counselors who go over there and buy the,
yeah,
wine, because they make their own blueberry wine, and you can go right in there and see the whole process.
Right.
It's unbelievable.
Right. Yeah, no, it's great. I mean, what's interesting is they're not beginning farmers. Larry always had something going for a long time, but when he changed careers,
uh-huh,
he was total passion for wine. But it is interesting, we've had in the area wineries open up and breweries, as we all know, we have a lot of breweries opening up in Northampton, East Hampton. But some of this are people doing their second careers. It isn't necessarily 20-somethings. Black Birch is a winery that their second career they're doing, and they just, you have to love what you're doing when you're working, you know, 60 to 80 hours a week, 51 weeks out of 52.
I mean, Larry and Susan, they're all over the place. I saw,
yes,
them at Atkins, because,
yeah,
I was talking with them there,
yeah,
bringing in their wine, tasting and so forth.
Right, right.
It's what you make out of it.
Yeah, and I think, to me, like, I think one value we have at CESA is we feel like there's something fractured in a community when all members in the community are not able to buy the food that's grown in there.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, something's wrong with that picture. Doesn't mean the farmers aren't doing their job. It might mean that the income gap nationally affects us in the community. And as you were saying, people aren't earning enough money to buy food that's grown in their community. And that's a societal problem. And I think farmers are part of the answer, but to me, it's sort of a metaphor for like, you wouldn't assume carpenters would solve housing. They have a skill set that's vital to it, but it's a societal problem.
Economic system.
These farms that apparently have closed, what do they do with their farms then? Are they subdividing them and putting in developments?
So it depends on the farm. I mean, in Massachusetts, we have a very active farm preservation program. And that came out of that 1970s effort I was talking about, that was 40 years ago, out of that food system plan. And so agricultural APR, agricultural preservation restriction. That program allows a farmer to sell the development rights, and the state pays for the development rights. And that means the farmer gets some value for its land, and then if the farmer goes to sell the land gets sold at a lower rate because it has to stay in farming and it can't be subdivided. Now, not every piece of farmland, that's why we have land trusts working really hard in the valley to preserve and protect more and more farmland, and the land trusts play a really essential role in that because oftentimes the state may not have all the money necessary. That's, you know, Clem Clay's previous role at the Trust for Public Land played a really important role for Broke Loop Northampton because it was able to put the money up until the money, they were able to hold the land until it could be bought from them and then brought to Broke Loop Northampton.
So
in that case, that land I think already had APR status, so it already, I think, was protected farmland, and Grow Food Northampton ensured that it would reflect the values of Grow Food Northampton and how it got farmed for the community. And so they raised money so that they could control the farmland to ensure it followed those values of the nonprofit acting on the community's interests. So that was really important. And I think Wayne does a very good job here as a planner for knowing what tracts of land are available, what's protected. The city has done a good job about having some restrictions on land. It's gone a little bit further than even what the states can sometimes do, but there's only a certain amount of money that the state has. The state's usually interested in protecting farmland that has, that's richer, more valuable agricultural land because they're gonna make decisions. So there's still a lot of farmland at risk, and then some farmers feel like, I've worked this land for 30 years and I want to sell it for what I can get for it. And if they don't find the price for the APR status of the development rights is adequate, they still may choose to subdivide. So it's a challenging thing as the next generation comes in because the average age of farmers nationally somewhere between 56 and 60. And so it's like, who's gonna come next? And if you're not in the family, it's very hard because you have to buy the land, you have to buy all the equipment. It's just a very high bar to come in.
Are there any loan programs for equipment?
There's lots, there are loans available and different depending on what your status is and what your experience is and what your financial status is. And there's some help from the USDA, there's technical assistance from groups like us.
Oh, I actually meant kind of a lending library, but it's good to know.
Oh, you mean like a tractor that would be lent to you?
And other kinds of equipment.
That's sort of challenging. Like, farmers do that informally with each other. You know, you may be in Hadley or, you know, different parts of the valley, and, you know, all of a sudden you're out of a product or your tractor just broke down, or, you know, some of that happens where people just informally do it. But it's not easy to lend equipment, as we all know, because people have different levels of care. So to own something jointly, I haven't heard many stories about farms doing that. Yeah, because, you know, I think it's just harder. You have to have a lot of trust.
The Swazlowski's potato farm, are they local with CISA and so?
Yeah, they're a local hero member. They're probably the largest potato farmers, maybe in New England, maybe even including Maine. They now have over 2,500 acres running down the Connecticut River Valley from Vermont into Connecticut. they're hitting their next, you know, the dads are retiring,
yes.
The daughters are stepping up, you know, they're in their 40s and 50s, and their spouses, and then next generation, they know that
they're a very hard working family. Always have been.
Yeah, it's amazing what they pulled off.
The emergency fund that you were talking about, is that just for weather-related emergencies, or?
Yeah, right now it's just for natural, well, it could be an earthquake, I mean, it could be, it's natural disasters. We've had conversations, that was the intent when it got set up, and we haven't strayed from it for lots of reasons. So, and we usually prefer to have more than one farm get affected. So I'll give you an example. Let's say a maple-producing farm had a fire, right? That's really hard for us to step in because the reason oftentimes a sugar house doesn't have fire insurance is because they can't get it often because an insurance company knows the risk might be high for the way that particular maple sugaring operation set up. So that's us stepping into a level of risk that is for just one farm, and so we've chosen to just keep it at natural disasters. And after Hurricane Irene, the next thing was in 2013, and I think it was February, there were hail storms that affected hoop houses and greenhouses. So we have three farms. And that was important because if they couldn't get a hoop house back up really quickly, they were going to lose everything and not be able to harvest it.
You were worried that you wouldn't have enough of that.
I know. I think we still ask him a lot of questions.
Una can sit with me. I think I'm already going to get a parking ticket, so I only have it for an hour. What if... you parked with me here.
As city councilors for...
Maybe I'll excuse myself for 2 minutes. I'll put more money in, and then if Una lets me sit with her, I will.
Sure.
And that way you really can start.
Nice and formal.
Yeah.
Pull up the chairs. Wait, I should just grab one of these.
You can take my chair off.
I'll take whichever one's comfortable.
I did bring some photos, but I don't know if that worked out. I told
Pam, and she, I think she went over and got paper when she needed something.
Okay, great.
I think it's ready to go.
Okay, cool.
Hi.
In all the time I've ever seen you, I'm not sure I've ever seen you without a child.
Oh, really?
I think in like many years now that I've been here, I've never seen you without
like
a kid.
I look like super mom. Yeah, I'm not really. I mean, I am. Yeah, but in the same way you are. You know, I don't know. We do our own things.
Yes.
They let you out of the house without a kid.
Yeah. Yes. Wiley is easier to drag with me places now, so.
I think Una wants to use some, put some photos up. Pam?
What's that?
I think Una wants to use
Okay. You have to give me a second to set this up.
I think I can take 7 photos and one of our little videos we made just awesome.
We do like photos.
Keeps it interesting, right? It's neat to look at. I did bring, and you guys probably have these already, but if you want for your record, your market descriptions here, and then I have fact sheets about the Snap and Save program that was launched thanks to CISA.
So I'm just saying this, and it's really beautiful.
Yeah, my mom made the.
She's
an artist. Yep, and then Seth Gregory did the layout for us. He's a local graphic designer and friend. Yeah, my mom is. She's the real deal. She's been doing it her whole life. But it was fun to collaborate with her. And it was mostly Ben.
We want to welcome you for being here on the Committee on Social Services, Veterans, Cultural, and. And
recreation.
It's
wow, it's a lot of things you guys.
I know, but it's adding all these things here. But anyways, I really appreciate you being here, all of us counselors do. And I know you know the counselor from Ward 4, Gina Louise Shira, and the counselor from Ward 7, Alyssa Klein, and the city counselor, Mary. Thank you very, very much for being here. I think it's very educational. And we are being videoed.
Okay.
Okay, so.
The back of your head is right behind you. It's the best place.
Plus, we're seeing your back.
So should I plug my computer into something? What makes the most sense here?
Do you have a USB drive?
Yeah, I have a that. Mm-hmm. Does that work?
Okay. I don't know what he called it. I'd have to look, but probably it says like city council photos or something.
Is that the door one?
Oh yeah, it was.
That door, it's, you don't, isn't there a sign on it?
Usually, yeah, but the front door didn't open.
Oh, the front door is locked.
Yeah. So I needed somebody
to. Why is that locked?
Oh, did someone have to let you in?
Yeah.
Huh. That should
That's supposed to be unlocked.
Oh, I saw someone walk back and forth. You thought they knew we were here. That's what they guess not. Sorry about that.
Yeah, that's it. So there's probably 7 photos.
Yeah, I'm not sure that they. Is this another one?
Yeah, you got it.
Okay.
Yeah, you can go back to it.
Let me just unlock the door.
Okay. And I have it for the nose thing. I have got allergies today. So
thank you.
Somebody open it. So yeah, I didn't especially prepare for this. I sort of figured I didn't know how big it was going to be either. So I just anyway. But we do have a few photos to just show you all. And Gina Louise was talking to me about the founding of the farm and the market, which both happened in 2008, and sort of the motivation behind that and what we see it's become. And and then just open it up for questions. Does that make sense?
Yeah, absolutely. I think we're all talking a bit, but the Snap and Save program, I think, is such an amazing thing to talk about.
Great, yeah, I'm totally happy to tell you about how that evolved. It was definitely an exciting, slow process, which I'm sure you all have experienced, that process of collaboration and finding the right collaborators and how long it can take to make something happen. But it was really exciting that happened this year. So yeah, we founded Town Farm and Tuesday Market both in 2008, so this is the eighth season. We started the market in September. The farm started as a CSA, and then my husband just really loves farmers markets. It's like he sold produce at a lot of markets in the DC area during his 20s for a big vegetable farm down there, and he also grew up in New York City and loves the green markets there, and just loves a good market. Every time we travel anywhere, we always visit and see what's there. So founding the market came out of necessity, partly because we as a farm couldn't get into either of the other markets, and so partly Ben being who he is was like, all right, I'll just make my own meat market, which is a great attribute most of the time to have that self-starter entrepreneur. I'm just gonna do it. And so we for a little while just wandered around the city feeling like where would make the most sense to do it, and so it felt like that space between Thornton's and Parking Garage was kind of underused and seemed like an opportunity. So, and at the time, the parking director, Bill, was like very open. And so we just sort of came in at the right moment, and we started with maybe 7 vendors, some of whom are still there, like Apex Orchards and Park Hill Orchards, which was mostly doing vegetables early on. Justinier, I think, came pretty quickly too. Maybe those 3 were there pretty early, so people knew that there was a market in Northampton, and they also could not access it. So I think that's part of what why those early people came in without really knowing us. They just trusted that, okay, this is gonna happen. So the market has evolved. I mean, I think we could just go to the next photo. This is just, you know, Candace. Maybe some of you know Candace. She worked at Paradise
copies for years as a graphic designer, and now she's a graphic designer in town. So she's worked on farms. You know, I think she's just, you know, been a regular customer. So one of the things that has evolved, I think fairly organically out of the market, has been a lot of different collaborations. So this was one with Families with Power. Mary Cowie, who was a shareholder of ours at the farm and also a market customer, was really interested. And she's a math teacher at Jackson Street. I don't think she's no longer, maybe she's more curriculum now, but anyway, she was really interested in creating a math book, very visual for parents and kids who maybe English is not their first language. So they made a book, took pictures at the market. We'd had her second grade come to the farm a bunch of times. And then it became a fundraiser for our food stamps Institute program. So it was this great sort of, you know, we didn't make tons of money off of it, but it was just a neat moment of collaboration. And so there's been a lot of that in the market.
I just found my copy of the book.
She brought kids from Families with Power. They, you know, took photos all around the market. So this was the page for number 3. It was a counting book. So 3 heads of broccoli. And I think it was in English and Spanish.
Yeah.
All right, you could go to the next one. This is just a picture of all the vendors' kids 1 year, and then Helen on the side. She just made her way in. So yeah, there's just been a great community built between the vendors overall, and that was something we were cared about, or just we really cared about bringing vendors in that we could. That we liked, that we communicated with, and you know, on some level that felt like we were the gatekeeper, but at the same time, it definitely did build a community of, you know, kids who are at the market. And some ebb and flow. Some are there as babies, and then they disappear for a bunch of years.
That's so precious.
Yeah. So I mean, I think this also just shows this kind of joyfulness of the kids at the market, and how that's really, you know, Julie's kids, like, it's like their second home.
Yeah, completely. They just like, they get there, they like take off their shoes, they make themselves right at home, and it's like, it's their favorite. They wait all week for Tuesday market. It's their favorite thing that they do during the week.
Yeah, I mean, some of that developed from them being at the school that is on our farm also. So there's sort of this other layer that came out of our farm with the preschool, where the kids would actually play setting up their market, right? They had their little stand in the classroom, so.
It's layers of community that have been built.
Right. You know, and actually one of my favorite recent stories is like, I was at market one day and all of a sudden a UPS woman came up with a letter that was for Ben that I had to sign. She's like, I didn't think he'd be at home today, so I decided to bring it to market. You know, I was just like, right. You know, this is like the place where
he's
in anymore. I know. Yeah, so this should have been the first photo, probably, because this is the first year or second year of the market, and that lovely man would wheel his piano to the market and play for hours.
I know, that's wonderful.
Where did he wheel it from?
He lived downtown, so
right? He had it near Pleasant Street.
Okay.
Did he or something? It was like, yeah, that's a spot there. Yeah.
Yeah, so those were the early, early days where we were only in this front part of the market, and he just sort of offered, you know, that just sort of came and happened. It was pretty great. Yeah, so you can keep going. This is also an early photo. Our farm used to bike everything to market, and then we got too big, and it was too crazy. But this is also one of the things we did for advertising for a couple years, is we would bike our signs around town right a couple hours before market started, and that became, we tried like a million things. That's sort of the nature of who we are. So that was one sort of, you know, guerrilla marketing. Well, we have a bike.
The dog's not on the side of the bike.
She wasn't born yet. No. The stylist. This was like a while ago. Before the preschool, before all kinds of things.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I think there's probably just a couple more. Okay, so this was the Edible Pioneer Rally woman, Mary. Okay. Last year, who did a fish cutting demo with fish from Berkshire Seafood. So that was another, you know, there are some educational things that have happened at market. Some years we've made recipes. This year we've had Deb doing some cooking, or she did cooking demos in early October. She's a neighbor of ours, and she's starting to, she wants to start a cooking class. business, and so she felt like, well, this is, would be a good first spot. So I don't have space yet, but here I can come and do demos. So yeah, so that's just sort of an example of that kind of thing that happens. All right. This is a cool story. So this is connected to our, well, so at our market it was called Food Stamps Times Two for from 5 years. We were raising money and doubling people's food stamps at the market up to $10. So it was a hustle, real hustle, towards the end of our program on our own, because it was, I think, $16,000 we had to raise was the most we had to raise as a market to be able to match those dollars. And so this was a girl who had her bat mitzvah, and she raised all the money for her bat mitzvah, went to our program at the market. So just really sweet. She also, I think she won like a recipe.
Yeah, she went
at the White House,
that,
right?
Wasn't it a White House?
Michelle thing? Obama.
Yeah, she like had some healthy sandwich recipe, yeah. Right? That she, so she'd been engaged in food and at the market and just decided that that's what she wanted to do. So that was a fun surprise moment. Here you go. Here's over $1,000. That's pretty awesome. Okay. And last year, and there's two of them. Is there? No, right? Okay. These are the bag shares.
I didn't even identify
my own. Well, it's far away.
Disguise, didn't want you to know. Didn't want you to know.
And that's our neighbor, Heidi.
Okay, so these awesome women sewed over 1,000 bags for our bag share program that we launched last year, which also was, I think, I don't know if it was
sent. I sent a bunch of those bags too, I'd like to sell.
Thank you.
In our very kitchen, we have a sweatshop once a month.
And I think we saw a picture of that, maybe. Ben,
it's pretty
Ben
remarkable.
Went maybe once, was it at your house?
He did come there? To our house yeah. Once, yep.
So yeah, we started the bag share program last year, that was really exciting. And then we built this trailer also, which has been kind of a trailer stage recycling. Craziness. But the bag share has been great. I mean, we use it all the time as, you know, market. We'll go and we'll shop and grab a bag, and then I have to return a whole chunk of them out to the trailer and wash them first. You know, it's definitely, you know, you have to be committed to use it, I think, or I'm committed to return them. But it's that was a great project to launch. Awesome. Great. And this is just photo of the market, the bounty.
That's nice. Great from this angle. It looks like some like massive.
Yeah, it does. Like,
it
goes
you
on
can
for
see
blocks.
A European country. Yeah, like that goes on for roads and roads.
Yeah, Ben is a very skilled photographer, so he gets the credit for all of these photos for the most part, except the one that he was in, I guess. All right, I don't know if there's any more. I think that might. Oh, okay. The uke. Right? Yeah. Let's see. Uke chorus through Downtown Sounds. I don't know if this is, I think this is last year. They didn't like where they were situated. We turned the trailer and the stage to go the other way. Thanks to me, one person who was part of it was quite upset about the orientation of the stage. But so that's fine. Anyway, we have music. This year, we didn't have quite as much music. It's definitely, you know, when I think about all the jobs I've done, at some point I was like, when did I become a booking agent? She's for music. Like, hunting people down. So anyway, but there have been some really great musicians who come every year, and it was fun to have this group. I mean, I think that's sort of the ideal, people who just want a venue to play, and they love what they're doing, and are relaxed and have it all too. Okay, there might be one more. Oh yeah, so Crimson Clover Farm, so they're part of the Northampton Community Farm. So for a while we had like 3 or 4 Northampton Community Farm people who were at the market. And when we started the market, well, maybe it was a little ways in, but we had to come up with criteria for what vendors we would bring into the market. We were really clear that we wanted to support Northampton farmers, new farmers who didn't have access to markets, or other people who didn't have access to markets. And also, we wanted all of our prepared foods to come from Northampton businesses. So there were some people who were grandfathered in for a while, but I think at this point, it's pretty much either they live or their business is in Northampton. That's the way we did it for prepared foods. So we really wanted to be in support of the local business community and not
feel like there was an against thing going on. So that's been interesting, you know, to have like, you know, share coffee. I mean, Tart Bakery, I think, has been an awesome addition to the market, and they seem to really love being there and do well there. So.
How many vendors are there?
So they're somewhere between 22 and 30, depending on the time of year. They would sort of max out in August. Yeah.
Sure, Laughing Tomato's been there for 3 years.
I don't know. I think maybe more than that now.
Really?
I know. Yeah.
That was an amazing addition too.
Yeah, and they are just lovely people. They do the Woodfire Pizza, and they live like right on the other side
actually.
Of the.
They live right over there.
Okay, yeah. And I just ran into him here because he's a translator also for Valley Medical Group. I ran into him at East Hampton, and he does translation services there. So anyway, I was just neat to sort of see people out in the community and other roles. But so yeah. So anyway, this was just a link to the Northampton Community Farm, which has also felt like an overall a good positive connection to Northampton, trying to figure out in an ongoing way how can we be supporting each other on the same season. So that might be it. Oh yeah, okay, Silas. So that's my son.
This is the 31st member.
It's true, man.
He is. He can push a pumpkin like nobody's
business. Sure, I know, please. But he really did grow all of his, I mean, he harvested them all on his own this year. It was pretty awesome. And he's going to do his own setup. No one's going to help him tomorrow. He's going to walk from our farm to market setup. So this was last year. There was an election. And this
I remember seeing
that. Yeah, that was kind of exciting. Okay. So yeah, any other, you can just turn that off too. Oh yeah, the staff and save. So yeah, let me just tell you the way that happened. So, you know, probably like the second year that we started. So we started accepting food stamps in 2010, and we got a grant. We got help from the Northampton Health Department that year. They bought our machine and applied our tokens, and they did that for all the markets. So there was a great connection with Ben Woods when he was, you know, whatever, I don't know what his terminology is. So that kind of continued that connection when the Healthy Hampshire Mass in Motion got started. I think Ben got that grant, and he gave the directive to sort of keep helping with farmers markets and accessibility. So anyway, Phil was probably there for some meetings, but we met with United Way and thought maybe they can be a fiscal sponsor, and we did the both Northampton markets and us. And for years, we were just trying to figure out, like, how can we pass this off? Like, this is a successful program, but we can't keep it going. So we just kept trying. And so Sarah Bankert, who works for Healthy Hampshire Mass in Motion, offered to help us do a convening. She's like, I can't help you with fundraising. I can't help you in any other way, but I can help you convene people. So kind of 2 marches ago, we did a convening, and like over 30 people came to it. Political people, like somebody from the stores office was there, and someone from the governor's office was there, and the food bank, and CISA, and farmers market managers from all the markets. So they all came together, and I gave a little presentation about what had happened at our market, and then Sarah talked about, like, you know, what are next steps. So it seems like there's interest here. And so that kind of alerted their office to, like, there was interest. So then later that summer, we met again with people who expressed that they had more time and ability to kind of contribute to it. And we kind of honed in on what we thought we could do. And, you know, where was the need? What was, you know, and what could we, as a group, come together and do? What match could we create? Does it make sense to go regional? Like, should we think whole state? Should we think just our region? And we were aware that there were some grants coming along that we needed capacity to even apply for, so that was also kind of a motivational force along with that. So Kelly, I think, was at that second meeting, maybe even the first meeting too, I don't remember. So eventually we honed in on it was me and Sarah Bankert and Kelly Coleman, who became a team and really sort of developed the program and decided to do it at the Amherst and Northampton summer markets. And we applied for some grants together that most of which were unsuccessful. We were able to
that we had gotten a grant from a family foundation to our market, and so we went to them as a group, and they gave us many more times the amount of money because we were now in this collective. So we launched in July at the Amherst Market and the Northampton Saturday Market and Florence Market and Tuesday Market all together at a $5 match. And some of the outcomes have been really positive. I mean, it's a lower match than we offered for a long time in our market. So in that way, I don't think the numbers are quite there in terms of usage, as they used to be a $10 match. But it's really brought together the market managers. I feel like for a long time, there was more competition than cooperation. And so having us all be in the same room, having us all figure out how to fundraise together, having us agree on this program looks good, and we're moving forward, and we're advertising together has just built kind of a great natural relationships between us all. And also it's paralleled CESA's effort to do the same thing in Hampton County. So all of our energy effort that's going towards building, you know, getting a graphic designer, figuring out the language, all that kind of stuff, they've been able to replicate in Hampton County. So it's felt like it was really great. Like, oh, all of this time put in is not wasted. It can be passed on to other places. So, you know, it's still, CESA's taken it on as a program now, which is really just awesome to feel like your board is supportive of that and you had a capacity to do that. And so it's really lifted that weight and let it feel solid, like it can go forward and also benefit people in other markets as well. So
how does the education get done to people who use SNAP to really know that this is available to them? Is there active outreach being done?
Yeah, I mean, Frank, Chicho Martinez is our, I don't know if he's like our local.
He's statewide. He runs the Helping Center program at the State Department of Transitional Assistance. He's in Amherst.
Sunderland, yeah.
But statewide, he's sort of responsible for this USDA monies that are going to be coming through that I mentioned before.
Oh, right. You were talking about the FINI. Yeah. So that will have a dramatic effect. But we found that a lot of the, anyway, Frank is constantly working to figure out how SNAP clients can get the information accurately about which markets offer this on a statewide level, because we are definitely not the only markets doing it. It's all over the place. So he really works on that level. But we found that really word of mouth is just a huge way that people find out about it. So, but we did a lot of outreach this year. I mean, we drove around to multiple places, including the Veterans Hospital, which I'd never been to before. It was fascinating to be up in that realm up there. It's like a whole other world. So, you know, figuring out where, you know, we made them in Spanish, so we've taken them to, you know, all different organizations, nonprofits. We went through the process of almost getting into the schools, and then we just figured it was too late in the season. So, you know, but we know how to do that now and have it designed in the right way, so hopefully we get approved and could go through the school, both Amherst and I think the schools maybe in the spring. So I think some of the feedback we got from this round of materials is like, simplify, you know, like, it's great, and oftentimes people get confused, so we were trying to make sure that all the information was there, but also just simpler, the better. Because for some people, like, it just takes so much paperwork, probably, that it's much easier if there's a face just telling you.
How many employees do you have working on your farm?
So our farm has kind of taken a hiatus this year. So last year we had 3 people who were working with us, and we were just selling at the farmer's market. And then we had 1 person who was working the farmer's market with me. And then this year we have 2 people, and I sort of took this behind the scenes a little bit more. But yeah, so, you know, they're not, you know, I feel like there's a little while when Grow Food Northampton was talking about, like, the benefits of agricultural jobs. And some of them are good, but a lot of them are fairly low-paying jobs, and we've tried to be, you know, at the, you know, reasonable level of paying our employees, but it's really challenging to be a small farm and sort of pay people well. So anyway, so I wouldn't say that that's like a huge boom to the local economy, our jobs at our farm, but we definitely think about it on the level of training people, and if they, you know, there's a huge amount of learning that happens for people who haven't lived on farms, and I think the small farms have a lot of diverse activities, so it's not like you're just picking cucumbers and squash all summer long. There's definitely a level of growth that bottoms out at a certain point, probably, but, you know, you try to keep people interested and engaged.
I feel like there's so many ways that the town farm has grown the economy, right? When you think about, I mean, you have a preschool that was founded at town farm, which is now expanded to twice its size. The Tuesday market, I think, has given an opportunity to a lot of vendors, like Laughing Tomato, it's a home for them once a week. So I feel like maybe you're not, I mean, maybe, yes, you don't have so many employees just all the time yourself, but there's so many ways that I think town farm has really helped many different businesses kind of get
into the community. And it's incredible. Just to have this event every week is incredible.
Yeah, and I think we have been kind of an incubator. You know, I think good farmers markets can be incubators in a lot of ways. So, you know, people like Hosta Hill took the leap to selling wholesale, and same with Carr's Cider, and, you know, maybe even Black Birch. You know, some things, like, it's not their big moneymaker, but it's huge outreach, and it brings people to their products, and then the wholesale takes off. So some vendors have definitely used the market in that way, and that's fine. I mean, we don't feel like we need to keep everyone there forever, but it seems like that's been, you know, and it's even just a place to try something out.
Oh, I think it's a perfect spot.
You know, if you're not sure if this business is going to fly, it's a good place to, you know, I know that Gold Thread, which has had all its different guys, and it's like they were trialing their elixirs there last year and trying to get customer feedback on which ones do you like, so people have used it, not trying to.
Guesses, I know it's hard to do counts of farmers markets, but I mean, you know, what's a decent number of people who might come?
Yeah, you know, I did have my staff do a count this year, and I feel like a lot of their counts, it was a rainy, set of Tuesdays this year. I think there are probably 500 people that come through every week.
So the other part you have to remember is that people don't necessarily just go to the market and leave. Than roaming the streets of downtown Northampton.
Yeah,
exactly. You know, and I think the Saturday market does that too. You know, people come downtown, they may get breakfast, they go to the market.
They're putting money in the meter.
Just like this meeting is done for you.
Well, no, I mean, I feel that way actually. You know, those parking attendants, they know when it's Tuesday and they're out ready to get to ticket people on Tuesdays for sure. Like, they see it as an opportunity moment. I'm well aware of that.
For the record, when I get a parking ticket, my first response is, oh, good. $15, $10 goes to public schools, and $5 goes to
What
if
I love that?
Is
that true? That's
where it goes? Yeah, it's like two-thirds of the budget goes to the school.
Oh, you're just basing it
on the overall budget.
Oh, the overall budget, not the portion.
I tip $10. Yeah.
That's great. I love that. Right, because you come from that budget place, that's why. The priorities project, right? Yeah, I mean, I feel like there's one.
You should figure out what percentage of it actually goes to the national defense budget. Your $15. Anyway, sorry.
Got it.
Yeah.
Any more questions?
No.
I want to thank you very much for being here.
Yeah.
Pleasure seeing you.
We have one quick conversation I want to bring up that you weren't here for, which was the question about local food hubs, which I basically said I don't understand what they are. And should Northampton have an indoor market space all year round? Your thoughts on that?
Right.
And, you know, I mean, I basically said I think it's hard to do because if you have a physical space, what's happening with it the other 6 days of the week or the other 4 days?
Yeah, mean, I think that's kind of a narrow sense of what it could be. I mean, I use Pike's Market in Seattle is kind of the example that I hear people talk about all the time in terms of the food hub, where you've got something going on 7 days a week and there are all different kinds of stalls and it's just, you know, this active place and it could be attached or not be attached to your food production place. I mean, it can be anything you want it to be, but it doesn't mean that it has to be kind of one day a week.
Farmers market. And even if you imagine that space where the market is now, if it was, like, in the summer it could be open up, but if in the winter it's now, it would be closed.
Yeah, I feel like it's a would be a question to really ask vendors and farmers about, because I feel like at the moment, I don't know what, you know, I don't know what it's like for all vendors in terms of the co-op, but I feel like the co-op is like offering so much local, so many local goods, and cornucopia that is so large to be too. So and State Street and Cereals, and so, you know, it's like, what are we trying to create in our, do we have a capacity in our pretty small town that's, you know, and All Foods Local is, you know, just closing. So it just seems
is it closing completely? I knew that they downsized after they upsized.
This weekend or something.
Yeah, I mean, and I think we've had successful, you know, the winter markets seem like they've been growing. I don't know, I wish they had data. I mean, I think that's more of where I would come at it from, is like, all right, let's get some data. Like, how much income is coming through the winter markets? You know, we do have that data now for Tuesday Market. We have since 2012, I think we've been, or 2013, we've been tracking data, income data anonymously. Mm-hmm. So I could tell you from year to year, from market to market, I would sort of take it on that level, and maybe used to feel more like, yes, let's do that, let's go there, but I feel like at the moment I'm not sure it's the directive to go. You know, we had visited the Ithaca market, it's three season and it's kind of enclosed and it's wonderful. To me it feels like it would need to be a collaboration between Emerson and Northampton in some way to create something like that. Like, I wouldn't just think that it was in this community. I think we would need to just sort of think, and maybe even Greenfield, like, sort of think like regionally about it and make it something that is in a location that would draw people from all those places. The Ithaca market is kind of weirdly, like, out of town. So,
Thank you, Ona.
Yeah, sorry.
Thank you so much.
Is it in the direction of Syracuse so that people from Syracuse actually come here, or is it? I don't know what's going to sustain a place like that.
It's three seasons, so but it's enclosed enough that they can go pretty late.
Well, you got to remember Cornell and the college were then.
Oh, wow. Years of birth, there you go.
But that's right, I'm just saying that that's right.
Clem, you can come right up
here. Clem,
they
want
you. They want you. Do you want you?
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to
step on up?
Sure. All right. Thanks for your timeliness,
everybody. Yeah, thank you for having us. Thank you for coming in. Feel free to follow up. Thank you. Clem, I want to thank you for attending our committee meeting on social services, veterans, cultural, and recreation. I think you know Councilor from Ward 4, Gina Louise Shiera, and also the Councilor from Ward 7, Alyssa Klein, and I'm City Councilor Marianne LaBarge from Ward 6, I'm the chair. Okay, go ahead and do your presentation.
You are being
videoed. I am being videoed, okay. All right, well, I don't have a lot to say. What's the best way for me to So I knew this was a small group, and so I wanted to be able to have you ask questions and we answer them. So that plus shortness of time leads me to not having a long formal presentation, because I think it's probably more valuable for me to be able to answer any questions that you have. But I'll give a brief overview of Grocery Northampton and what we're doing toward sustainability in the agricultural realm, but also how we're looking at sort of the social justice aspects of the food system in Northampton. And does that sort of cover the bases that make sense to all of you? Okay, fit with the goals of So I think you all know, GrowFood Northampton formed in 2010, owns as a result of the campaign that sort of got the organization into being, owns 120 acres of farmland in Florence, the Northampton community farm. We lease most of that farm out to private farmers, anywhere from 1 to 90 acres, depending on the farmer, and anywhere from a, you know, 1 year lease to a 99 year lease. So we have a wide range of ways that we try to solve the problem of land access for farmers, which is a big problem throughout the country, particularly in New England. There's a lot of attention being paid to how do we get a new generation of farmers on the land, and an outgoing generation is not always able to keep in the family. And so that's one of the areas that Brookfield Northampton is very proud of having done something on, and that we want to continue to focus on in the future, is making sure that there's an opportunity for farmers who want to be in farming for a good long time and provide local food for local markets, have access to that land. Of course, at 120 acres, we have a big farm, the biggest community farm in Massachusetts. But at the same time, we don't always have land available at any given moment to lease out, because we really want to, we don't look at ourselves primarily as sort of a, what they call an incubator farm model, where you help people get started and give them an acre or two for a couple of years, and then they need to move on to another situation. We want to actually really be able to solve the land access problem for farmers. If they want to stay, like Crimson and Clover Farm, our anchor farm, they want to be there for a long time. So they've got a 99 year lease, and that's, you know, in many respects equivalent to ownership, but also there are terms to that lease that give additional public benefits to the land. So they're required to primarily sell locally. They allow us onto the land for field trips and other educational programs. They use sustainable growing practices. So these are things that we can put in the lease that they would like to do anyway, but that it sort of codifies that in a useful way. But in other ways, they're very independent. They operate their own business. We're not telling them which crops to plant and when and in which fields, and there's none of that sort of micromanaging. At the other end of the spectrum, we do have some smaller farmers who may eventually sort of graduate from our farm if they're able to buy a farm or get a longer term lease or get more land than we have available. So we're really trying to meet the needs across the spectrum of farmers whose interests in serving the local community are compatible with our mission. So that's one piece of what we do. At some point in the future, but certainly not in the immediate future, we may try to do that on even more land. So it's a conversation that we're open to having in the community about whether what we've done already could be replicated right here in new ways or similar ways, but to continue that part of our mission, to make the land available to farmers. We know there are more young farmers or employed farmers who would like to be farming in Northampton, but there are numerous obstacles to achieving that goal. One of them is access to land, infrastructure, access to capital. There's sort of a long list, but being able to have a sort of a friendly landlord who's flexible and willing to meet your needs in terms of how long you want to commit is really a nice thing. And being able to do that as close to friendly markets as we are here in Northampton is a big plus as well. And then a whole other piece of our mission, but we see them as very connected, is trying to make sure that the food that's grown on our farm, and more broadly, I think over time, we'd like to be thinking about not only our own farm, but more farms in town and in the region, are meeting the food needs of the local population, and not just, not only people who can easily afford to buy local food, organic food that's grown the way they want it, but people who might not otherwise have access to that food. But we think that a sustainable food system means that over time, we really work towards a goal of everybody having access to sustainably grown local food. And so we're putting a lot of effort into that side of our mission these days. You may have seen in the Gazette, we just got a grant from the Harvard Pilgrim Healthcare Foundation that's going to help us to solidify and expand a few of our existing programs and also work on some new programs. And we're really excited, grateful for that opportunity, and excited about it. So currently we partner with the Senior Center, for example, do a senior farm share program, which is nestled within a larger regional program that CESA runs. Phil was just here. But we sort of run it independently and fundraise for it independently, but coordinate with them on broader outreach and taking surveys of participants and so on. But that program gets, this year we serve 55 seniors in partnership with the Senior Center. They sign up for a small box of, or bag of vegetables for 10 weeks. We buy those vegetables, we pay 90% of the cost, the seniors pay 10%. Our volunteers pick the vegetables up at Crimson and Clover Farm and bring them to the Senior Center. The Senior Center's volunteers divvy them up into the bags. Seniors come on a Tuesday afternoon and pick them up. And so it's a nice way to get that local produce into the hands of people who probably aren't going to show up at the farmer's market every Tuesday or go out to Florence to Crimson and Clover Farm and be a full CSA share member. So we think there are a lot of opportunities like that to reach deeper into the community and overcome some of the transportation and other obstacles that people have, as well as obviously the income obstacle. Those are all low-income seniors, and we're providing a very generous benefit.
Is the Harvard Pilgrim Grant making this happen, or this exists?
We were doing it already. Right? We were doing it already, and we expanded this year to 55. Over the next couple of years, with Harvard Pilgrim support, we hope to be up to 100. So, one of the ways, for example, that we'll take that on is that we know that some seniors would like to participate. We, meaning us, spoke with Northampton and the Senior Center, having had conversations about this. And I rely on the staff of the Senior Center to really sort of provide the intel in a sense, but we also do surveys. And transportation is an obstacle. So if we can use some of that Harvard Pilgrim funding to introduce a delivery option and subsidize the delivery as well, then we know that there will be even more seniors who got to sign up.
This is every Tuesday?
This is every Tuesday for 10 weeks, July, August, mostly in July and August. I think we started maybe at the very end of June and ended at the August. It's over with for this year, yeah. And so then another possibility might be to extend that season if there's demand for that.
And how much does it cost them?
It costs them $1 a week. And we pay the other $9 a week. So it's a really great deal. And these are seniors who meet one of four possible income tests. And so they're low income, but we have a lot of ways. If you participate in a number of other programs that are income, sort of means tested programs, then that qualifies you.
And what's the name of the program at the Senior Center?
It's this, we call it the Senior Farm Share Program.
Okay, thank you.
And are there people on the waiting list, or do you know that there's more capacity?
Well, there were, and we were going to expand to 40 slots this year. We did 30 last year, and Michelle Dillon at the Senior Center told me she had 55 applicants, and I made an executive decision to just everyone who applied got in this year. Last year there was a lottery, so it depends on our funding. So having the Harvard Pilgrim Grant to help support that, as well as the support we get from our donors, people in the community, business supporters, and so on, allows us to continue to expand the program.
Plus the fact is you're near McDonald's House, Fruit Street Apartments, Walter Savo's, walking distance.
Exactly. And so these are the kinds of markets, in quote, sort of soft quotes there, that we want to tap into, because they're not thought of as great marketing opportunities for a private farmer who's trying to figure out how to, you know, pay the tractor bills and all of that, because these people don't necessarily have as much money, they can't come to the farm as easily. But for us, if we can get in the middle and make them a good market for our farmers by subsidizing the difference between what they can afford and what it costs the farmers to produce this food, we think that's a really good role for us. We're not telling anybody they have to eat these vegetables, and we're not telling anybody they have to grow them, but if there's a gap in between the two, we can help to bring those two parties together, use volunteers, use the Senior Center, use these partnerships, then it works really well.
So say you had a husband and wife who are eligible to be in this program, and you're saying you have carrots or whatever, how do you know how much to give a husband and wife?
Well, that's a good question, and we it's the same amount for every participant, whether it's one or two people, is how that we have done it. One possibility would be to introduce one and two person options. So far, we haven't done that because the program's just been going for a few years and we've maintained consistency with CESA's regional program, which operates with a single size. But it is something that we could explore. But we get feedback from, we do the survey at the end of each season, and we get pretty good feedback. And we do get a few people saying it's a little too much and a few people saying it's a little too little. Most people are satisfied with the quantity. So we're fairly comfortable that we're doing, if we're going to have a one-size-fits-all model, that it's about right. But introducing two options obviously would increase satisfaction. It couldn't really decrease it, I don't think. So it just changes the logistics a little bit. So again, with this grant from Harvard Pilgrim, we may be able to look at some of those alternatives. So far, we've focused on just trying to create something that we know there's demand for, and it's very simple to operate, because we don't want to spend a lot of staff time operating it. And this way, we're able to use volunteers to do the transportation, the divvying up, all of that. It doesn't take a whole lot of my staff time. It doesn't take a whole lot of the senior center's staff time to put this program together. So that's one example. Another one is out at the farm. People who are on SNAP benefits, formerly known as food stamps, but I think most people have gotten used to the terminology of SNAP participation at this point, can purchase a CSA share or a farm share from Crimson and Clover Farm using those benefits, and they can purchase it at half price, and we pay the other half. So that's another thing that our donors have helped us, enabled us to do, to provide that difference and give an incentive for people who are on these SNAP benefits to get healthy local foods, and something that we'll be expanding as well in the coming years. And so that's for people who can get to the farm and participate that way and want a larger amount of food for a longer season. It's a great deal. It's not the 90% subsidy that we're able to do for the senior centers, but still at half price, it's a better deal than you'll ever get at the grocery store, even on food from out of state or out of country. So.
And are they doing that weekly, or do they buy a share like at the beginning of the season?
It's
a bigger amount of money.
It is a bigger amount of money, but they can pay monthly, and so and they can pay with the card. So it is a little bit more complicated because the CSA model normally is to pay the full season's price up front, and so it's been modified a little to work with SNAP benefits. And there's actually, in addition to having some help in the next few years with the Harvard Pilgrim grant from this, there is a great new state program that will be coming into effect in 2017 that we will be trying to integrate our program with. And that's it's a USDA grant that the State Department of Transitional Assistance, which runs the SNAP program, recently received. And their goal is to incentivize fresh fruit and vegetable purchases at farmers markets, mobile markets, CSAs, there's one more, 4 points of purchase that are sort of biased towards local food, even though they're not always local, and that will have a slightly different way of operating, but essentially will allow people to use their benefits for these purchases. And so we think this is great. It's it's one of the things that we've been doing for a while, and we've helped to innovate along with others, and along with UNA, for example, at the Tuesday market here, where they do similar things at the farmers market. This is going to allow that type of program to go statewide. It won't be quite as generous as what we're doing, so we intend to continue to supplement and make sure that people don't sort of fall back to a lower benefit level than what we would prefer to provide. But we'll certainly try to integrate our operations with that program and take advantage of some available public funding. And so ultimately, federal money coming through the state in partnership with the DTA and the Department of Agricultural Resources. So that's another program that we're really proud of and hope to expand. Then there are a few others that I'm worried we might run out of time here, but one that I would like to mention, just because I'm really excited about it, but I want to also, and it was in the paper a little bit, I also want to be careful to give a caveat, which is that I haven't explored the partnership adequately to be sure how it's going to work or that it's going to work, but I've had enough conversations to be optimistic about it. And that is taking the the senior farm share model that I just mentioned, and in partnership with the senior center, and trying to find a way to partner with schools to do something similar. And the reason behind that is essentially that a lot of families who may never sign up to be a CSA participant out at the farm in Florence come to school every day, whether it's at the end of the school day or the end of an after-school program and or sport, and so they're already there. And if the schools are willing to work with us on creating a pickup location, so this is not farm to school in the cafeteria, that's a whole other dimension, but this is getting boxes of produce or bags of produce that people have said in advance they want to buy, and we are providing a healthy discount on to the schools simply for distribution purposes. It seems to me that there's a lot of room to experiment there. Our hope is to find one school to partner with and pilot this in the coming year with the Harvard Program Grant support. And then if it works, and we can work out all the kinks, because I'm sure there will be some, then potentially expand that to other schools. So, you know, there are a third of the kids in this in the school system are on free or reduced lunch, so it's a public income. So there's a lot of need there, not only for a food program that gets kids food in the schools, but also for thinking about, you know, can we help them access healthy food at home? Can we reach the families through local food? And so I'm really excited about trying to develop that program and develop partnerships with the schools. We already partner with the schools for field trips and things like that, but this would be a way to really make sure the food is getting out.
It would be great if opening the doors on that would be excellent.
Yeah. It'd be great if something like that could continue through the summer, of course, because that's one of the problems is that kids have free and reduced lunch during the school year, but in the summer, they don't have that program.
That's right.
So any way to bring more food to them.
That's right. No, that is tough. And what we're imagining right now is that we'll develop a partnership. I don't want to rush it because I know there's a lot of things that you need to talk through in trying to work with the school as a partner on something like this. And so I don't want to rush it, and I don't want to ram it down anybody's throat, but I do want to work towards a pilot in the fall so that we would have sort of this season, September, October, as a maybe a 10-week pilot, see how that works, and then if it's working well, then we could think about, is there a way to begin before kids leave school and work something through the summers? So I'm not sure how that will all work at this point, because it's really critical to get feedback on the practical aspects of these things from the people who know these families and work with them regularly. And we don't pretend to have that expertise, but it's worked really well for us with the seniors to rely on the senior center staff's expertise in making those connections and doing the outreach and advising us on what will work and what won't. And I think the same can be true in the schools.
What about doing something like that through the housing authority and working with some of the housing projects in town and things like that?
I think that's a great idea. That's a great idea. So, you know, one of the things that I tried to do when I wrote the Harvard Pilgrim grant proposal was to say, sort of to ask for permission over the 3-year period, which is their typical grant cycle, to experiment with some things and, you know, jettison the things that don't work and expand the things that do. And they're very comfortable with that approach. So, you know, I'm going to look at next year as we know the things that are already successful that we can expand and what it will take to expand them. But in terms of new ideas, doing some experiments, doing some piloting, figuring out what works, what are the partnerships that we can really build on, and then expanding where there's sort of the path of least resistance or the greatest opportunity. I think we'll have the support of the foundation to do that, and I'm confident, and I think that's how we'll get the most impressive results.
That's just like with Casa Latina in Florence.
Yep.
With the outreach that we're doing with Casa Latina through the Collegiate from Hospital and in East Stanton. So I think it's really good to look at agencies and so forth that really are low-income families and could use that type of support.
Can I make one final pitch?
Sure, you can. Oh,
I announced the.
Oh, did you announce the festival? Okay,
at,
great.
At council last week.
Oh, great.
So I was on the website and I noticed you have a picture on the website of the mayor. And he may not have been the mayor, he might have been the
mayor. He was the mayor.
Was he the mayor at that point?
Yeah.
And
the person who's the ward four councillor before me, Pamela Schwartz.
Right. Yes.
Catapulting vegetables.
I have invited the mayor, but I haven't got a firm response yet. So if anybody has.
Well, on camera, I told him I expected to see him.
Oh, great. Oh, good, good, good. Thank you.
Put some public pressure on him.
I will leave a few of these. And yes, Lily, my predecessor, Lily Lombard, and her husband John were out a couple of days ago setting up the veggie slingshot. So it's ready to go. So can I leave a few things here for you?
Yes, of course.
Great.
That's great that you're doing that. That's a really fun event.
Hope to see folks on Sunday.
Yeah.
So any other questions for me?
I don't think so.
I have two quick questions. I think they're quick. Are you still doing the bringing school groups in and doing education?
Yes.
For kids? And is that something that's also getting covered by the new Harvard Pilgrim grant, or is that something that's already kind of?
No, we've been fortunate this year to get two sources of funding that have helped to pay for a significant amount of that, and then we just rely on our donors to pay for the rest. But we are expanding our field trips this year. We've got 20 slots for up to two classes each scheduled the last week of October and the first week of November, and I think about 80% of those are full. But if anybody knows teachers who may have missed the announcement through their principals that went out about 6 weeks ago, please encourage them to look that up on our website. There's a form they can fill out, and so we're filling in the last of those slots. So we will have, you know, somewhere between 600 and 1,000 students, I think, coming out. Those are short trips, but the kids love them. They remember them. I'm hoping that they'll think of them when we are able to pilot this this in-school farm share program. River Valley Co-op and the Northampton Education Foundation each made us a $3,000 grant for supporting that program. So that's been a really, really big help to be able to, with confidence, expand the offerings that we had. And then we'll hope to do more in the spring than we've done in the past as well.
I'm just worried that we're kind of up on our 6 o'clock time, so we
can't do this. But we're 5 minutes late for him, so let's get
respect. Do you have another
question?
Okay. Well, there are kind of two parts to it. One, it was kind of interesting hearing Phil and Una before you, and each of them referencing each other and Rural Foods Northampton. I'm just curious from your perspective how Rural Foods Northampton is interacting with these other organizations and farmers markets and how you rely on each other, if there's any issue of kind of competition with what you do, or just how you support each other, kind of just float all boats higher agriculturally in the valley.
Yeah, no, I think we definitely do all do that and have that intention. I think probably rather than direct competition, we all just get very busy with the things we're trying to accomplish. And so there's always less collaboration than you would like on a day-to-day basis between organizations. I mean, that's not unique to us. It's just collaboration takes that extra energy that we really try to find, and so do they. And we've done some great stuff together in the past. And I know, you know, this winter I worked with Una on co-sponsoring a seed swap and a movie and things like that. And then May hit, things got crazy, and I'll have to admit that other than sharing grant proposals and some of these sort of larger projects, thinking about food security issues on a more regional scale, and going to PD Grows and other regional type meetings, I think all of us find that these 5 or 6 months, just like farmers, are so hectic for us that we talk about wanting to sit down and meet more than we get to do it until, we get a few months in the winter where we can do more of it. So for me, having come in just in January, that's been a real lesson. I've been a farmer, I know how cyclical that is, but seeing how cyclical the work that Grow from Northampton and the farmers markets and CESA do is as well. We're busy all year round, but there's room in some seasons to move certain projects forward. And I think collaborative regional projects is one of those, is an example of the type of thing that it's good to really seize the moment when you have time in the winter and try to do more of that. So I certainly hope that we'll be able to do more of that. I had applied for a federal food security oriented grant that both organizations would have been involved in. We didn't get that one, but I'm hoping with the hard work of the funding that there will be opportunities to and with the state funded program that I mentioned, there'll be opportunities to think a little bit outside of what we do on a day-to-day basis and more focus more on those connections.
Where's your office? Is it still on the street?
Yeah, it's right above Broadside.
Okay, so you haven't moved from there?
No, we're still right there.
And just the other part of that question that I wanted to ask, and you mentioned food security, is Springfield and Holyoke have urban farming kind of programs, and I'm wondering if there's going to be some attempt or there's some way in which the work that you're already doing is incorporating folks from all places, or if there's some idea to start kind of an urban farming kind of model and again, some of the housing authority developments or something along those lines.
It's a good question, and it's one that crosses my mind with some frequency, but and actually the Harvard Pilgrim folks asked me this when they had me do an hour call and answer questions about my grant proposal to them. And ultimately my answer to them is the same one that I'll give you, and it may not be the answer for all time, but it's really that our work is nowhere near done in Northampton. There's so much work to do to try to raise awareness of the needs of how many low-income people there are, how many options there are to accessing fresh, healthy, local food for people who are here. And that's not to say that there aren't lots of people who could benefit from what we do in other communities. But we are, for the foreseeable future, I think we'll keep our focus primarily on Northampton, simply because there's so much further we can go, so many more needs that we can meet here. And so we would want to, I think our model would be more to partner with organizations that already have a regional scope, mm-hmm. where there are opportunities, a CESA for example, so that we're contributing in some way. And our senior farm share program in some ways is an example of that. They run it as a regional program. They had, I think, about 420 of those shares, and of those, 55 were ours in Northampton, and we can really do our piece here. But
just so you know, that I was asking about Northampton doing kind of that model of urban farming, or housing authority development in Northampton. But I understand what you were saying.
Yes. I think in the over the next few years, those are opportunities worth exploring for us, and. So we may do more with that. Certainly we have the community garden, and so we provide opportunities for a lot of people who can, if they can get there, to get out to the garden and grow their own food as well, which has some similarities to some of those other projects.
Thank you.
Thank you so much. Nice meeting you. Hope to see you on Sunday.
Yeah, definitely. Okay, so anyways, I just want to talk very quickly, about the schedule for the month of November. I have Sherry Hall Smith, who's the board president of Casa Latina, and Cliff McCarthy, who's the president of the Pioneer Valley History Network, who's going to come in and talk about their celebration for the whole year. And then I have Lucy Hartree from Tapestry Health, and the new CEO also has been invited, and I heard she's been fantastic. So that's what we got scheduled. And also too, if I cannot attend that meeting, I will notify both of you, and one of you can take over the meeting once the agenda is submitted.
Move to adjourn.
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
That was great.